their attempt to explain growth, economists had to move from capital as the main reason for growth to technology, and now started to believe that resources and technology couldn't explain fully the difference in economic growth across the world. They started to move towards examining the internal structure of the economy and particular characteristics of each economy. The new growth theory is an approach that focuses on economic growth and how it can occur from within the economy, rather than rely on external aid or external investment in capital. How can economies develop from within? Economies started to look at the incentive mechanism to foster innovation from within the economy. This led to a new area of interest called endogenous growth. Endogenous growth is growth driven by factors inside of the economy. The production function needs to be adjusted. Our production function is more complete with GDP equal to A, which is technology, times our production function, which our production function now includes capital, human capital, and institutions. Recall that institution is the environment in which decisions are being made. In our previous discussion, we talked about growth concepts and we defined institutions, and now we see that they can lead to endogenous growth. Modern growth theory provides policymakers with specific policies to help increase economic growth. As we look around the world, we can see countries growing because they have introduced positive institutions and reform. Positive institutions, we mean things like transparent and consistent government, freedom of the press, individual freedoms, private property rights, stable money and prices. We also can look around the world and see negative institutions, corruption, political instability, lack of individual freedom, all restrict growth. They hinder people from making decisions and long-term investments, which are both needed to spur innovation. Positive institutions to foster economic growth and to increase endogenous economic growth can be summarized as political stability and the rule of law, private property rights, competitive markets, international and open trade, flow of funds across borders, efficient taxes, and stable money and prices. An economy that invests in developing healthy institutions will allow for endogenous growth. And graphically, our production function increases by implementing policies and private property rights and enhancing the decision-making process for our citizens, where they now have the incentive to create their own technology. They become reliant on developing their new ideas and productivity. We increase their output from Y1 to Y2 by holding capital constant. This actually is a cheaper method to spur economic growth. Develop the infrastructure. The economy has K capital now, but it uses it more efficiently and produces more. A good example of this is Chile. From 1900 to 1985, Chile grew at a rate of less than 1%. In 1975, Chile began drastic economic reforms. From 1985 to 2016, growth averaged 3.7%. These economic reforms unleashed a new economic environment, allowing people to take the same resources but use them more productively. And that's why we look at institutions as a way to create endogenous economic growth. Institutions allow for a sustainable growth model. However, institutions can easily deteriorate. That is why policies and governments matter. Bad reforms are as possible to implement as good reforms. There are many examples from around the world where economies once were thriving and now are not doing as well because institutions were eroded. As we close off this discussion, it's important to recap the difference between the growth models. Solo growth model 1 relied on emphasis on capital as the source of economic growth. When we look at that model, there are two main concepts that come out of it: the idea of steady state and convergence hypothesis. Solo growth model 1 does not reflect all possible growth we observe in the world. The solo growth model 2 now relies on technology, but the problem with that is it assumes technology is exogenous. Other than luck and external investment, it was hard to spur economic growth. Also, continuous investment by local and external governments or organizations were needed to continue growth. Once the funds stopped, so did the growth. Modern growth theory, or endogenous growth theory, allows for endogenous growth and for policymakers to directly impact the growth possibilities. Modern growth theory relies on the development of institutions that foster endogenous growth. And these institutions rely on people being able to make long-term decisions easier. From an economic standpoint, these are the three models that we use to explain economic growth and the evolution of our ideas around economic growth. What this should highlight to you is how important it is to look at what models we currently have and how to improve upon them and to reflect exactly on what's happening in the world. But most importantly, we have to implement these models to see if they work or not. Finally, an important thing is real-world observation allow us to see what else is happening or allow us to ask the right questions about what's happening in the economy. You too can influence economic ideas by observing and questioning the things that happen around you. That, in a nutshell, is economic growth theory.